and welcome to Sunday service here with us at Emmanuel Presbyterian Church. We're just so excited that we can gather and worship together, even though we might be scattered physically, and we're looking forward to what God has in store for us today. Before we begin, if you haven't done so already, I just want to encourage you to go and download the worship guide on our website, which is epcministry.org. And in this worship guide, you'll find song lyrics, announcements, sermon reflection questions, etc., to help us worship well as one body with one purpose. So again, if you haven't done so, please go to our website, epcministry.org, and download the Sunday worship guide. Every Sunday at Emmanuel, we begin with the call to worship. And the call to worship is simply God's invitation to his people through his word to stop in humility and to reflect on what we are doing together and who we are here to worship. Today's call to worship comes from Psalm 119, verses 1 through 8. Psalm 119, verses 1 through 8, and this is the word of the Lord. Blessed are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep his testimonies, who seek him with their whole heart, who also do no wrong but walk in his ways. You have commanded your precepts to be kept diligently. Oh, that my ways may be steadfast in keeping your statutes. Then I shall not be put to shame, having my eyes fixed on all your commandments. I will praise you with an upright heart when I learn your righteous rules. I will keep your statutes. Do not utterly forsake me. Amen. As God speaks through us through his word, would you take a moment and quiet your hearts and minds and come before him in a prayer of preparation? Let us pray.
Upon you, Lord, how mighty dear. Be healed. Eyes be
Amen. Our God is truly an altogether and worthy God above all things. And we will never understand the true burden and cost that Jesus took on the cross for our sins. And despite that we are unable to grasp his sacrifice or ever hope to repay him, God continues to call us not only children, but invites us into his presence to worship. Understanding this, we come to a time of confession where we humbly lay our lives before him in confessing in an act of faith that trusts in the knowledge that God not only hears but forgives us. And so would you read with me together in one voice the call to confession from Psalm 32, verses 3 through 5. Psalm 32, verses 3 through 5. Let's read this together. For when I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not cover my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. Amen. Emmanuel, at this time, let us come before him in a prayer of confession of our sins. Let us pray. Sisters, hear God's word of assurance and mercy from 1 John 4, verses 13 through 15. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world, that whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him and he in God. Amen. With the assurance that God hears us and forgives us by his grace, let us confess our faith together by reciting the Apostles' Creed as one church. Let's pray together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead, he ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we come before you today in thankfulness and in awe of you. You are creator, healer, and judge. You are a loving God whose words are true and you keep your promises. We come before you today as children who have been consumed with our own cares. Forgive us for the many times we have not sought you first and relied on our own knowledge. We turn our hearts and minds now to the many things you desire for us to see and pray for. Lord, we pray for those who do not know you personally. We ask that you continue to knock on their hearts and provide opportunities to see your love and beauty. We pray for those who have been affected by COVID and are suffering. We pray that you will provide healing and resources to provide comfort. We pray for our world leaders who are making decisions on behalf of the people. Please give them wisdom and discernment. We also pray for our church leaders that they will not cease seeking after your heart and ways on their knees. Father, we pray for our youth and the following generations. We ask that you reveal yourself to them in a real way, providing clarity in this confusing world that is filled with illusions. Lord, have mercy. Lord, help us to hear and help us to overcome. Father, we also thank you for so many things. We thank you for the freedom to worship freely. We thank you for your word that teaches us and gives us hope. We thank you for the fellowship of our church brothers and sisters. May we continue to sharpen each other and grow. We thank you again for your faithfulness and for the missionaries who are serving in various parts of the world in your name. Father, may we remember that there is truly power in your name. Finally, as we prepare to hear your word to us today, help us to let go of our own thoughts, but be open vessels to receive the sermon with the help of the Holy Spirit. May it take deep roots so that may we see fruits of the Spirit manifest in our lives. We pray all of this in the powerful name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Hello and welcome again to Sunday worship here at Emmanuel. My name is Paul and I am privileged to serve on the pastoral staff here at EPC. Before we go into God's word, I want to share some announcements and updates of things that are happening here in our community. The first thing is that the sign up for the 15-minute Zoom meetings with me is up and live on our website. Please go and click on the link and sign up for an opportunity to get in touch and to share what God has been doing in our lives and share also any prayer requests that we might have for one another. And this is just a great opportunity for me to meet and to get to know the community here in the midst of COVID and virtual distancing, or virtually meeting and social distancing. So I look forward to meeting with you. The meetings will start this week, Wednesday, I believe, and there are slots for the next month on various days. So I look forward to getting together with you through Zoom. The second thing is that the EPC Men's Ministry is hosting a seminar that is open for all members of our community, not just men. Sunday, January 31st at 4 p.m., we'll be having Pastor Yuan come and lead us in a time of encouragement as we reflect on spiritual rhythms for shelter in place. You can find the event on our Facebook group by searching Emmanuel Presbyterian Church English Ministry. We'll work on fixing that name or shortening it very soon. But please go there. We'll be placing a link on our website this week, Tuesday, so that you can, our website also on Tuesday, so that you can RSVP, hopefully directly on the event page on Facebook. The EPC Beulah Women's Ministry is also having a kickoff event for the new year on Sunday, January 24th from 3 to 5 p.m. And here is a short video that they have shared with us to show you.
Oh, into Christ?
That looks awesome. I'm so sad that we can't go as brothers, but my wife Charlene will be sharing her testimony, followed by a time of fellowship and arts by making sculpture art. Information will be made available on our website also this week, Tuesday, so please go there for the Zoom link and the password, and they're even able to send you art supplies if you don't have the required materials at home. So please check out our website, epcministry.org, this week, Tuesday, for more news. The Sunday worship guide will be posted each week on Saturday on our website, and I hope that it's helpful for you, that it gives you context, and especially we not just want to show you what's happening in and through the worship, but the space for reflection questions are the things that we can not only think about ourselves, but ask one another as we continue to live out the gospel as families, as communities, and just being able to share how God continues to deepen and widen in our lives beyond just the Sunday sermon. So please look out for that and download it in preparation for Sunday worship. And finally, if you are new, if this is your first time here, welcome, and especially a warm welcome to you. We have updated our website. If you would go to epcministry.org, and on the top right side of the website, there is a button called Newcomers. And we just ask for some of your contact information because we'd love to share a welcoming email and give you more insight and access to the news and also the regular day-to-day community that we have throughout the week and month. We're excited that you're here, even though we can't meet in person, and we look forward to contacting you and walking with you after Jesus and the gospel. So thank you for being a part of our worship today. And now let us prepare our hearts for God's word. We're continuing in our series called Hope in the Storm, a Gospel-Centered Perseverance, and this is the second Sunday that we are in our new series together. Just a quick recap of the first week last week. The sermon was titled, Are You Okay? Out of Matthew 26. And we looked at the example and the model of Jesus Christ when he was experiencing anxiety, fear, and difficulty in life, how he models that his first inclination, his first reaction in these situations was to pray. It was to turn to his Heavenly Father in the Garden of Gethsemane and to pour out his heart in an authentic revelation of where he was at, trusting that not only that the Father would hear him, but that the Father was present with him and that he would strengthen him into what is to come. We talked about how prayer is not about changing God, but about changing our hearts, about realigning who we are in the image and in the wisdom of God. And today we'll be turning our hearts towards God's word to see how waiting and persevering, specifically out of his wisdom, out of scripture, is the strength that we are able to hold on to. And so would you turn with me to Isaiah chapter 8, verses 11 through 22. Isaiah chapter 8, verses 11 through 22. And when you're there, will you rise to honor God's word with me? This is the word of the Lord. For the Lord spoke thus to me with a strong hand upon me and warned me not to walk in the way of this people, saying, do not call conspiracy all that this people calls conspiracy, and do not fear what they fear, nor be in dread. But the Lord of hosts, him you shall honor as holy. Let him be your fear, and let him be your dread. And he will become a sanctuary, and a stone of offense, and a rock of stumbling to both houses of Israel, a trap and a snare to the inhabitants of Jerusalem. And many shall stumble on it, they shall fall and be broken, they shall be snared and taken. Bind up the testimony, seal the teaching among my disciples. I will wait for the Lord who is hiding his face from the house of Jacob, and I will hope in him. Behold, I and the children whom the Lord has given me are signs and portents in Israel from the Lord of hosts, who dwells on Mount Zion. And when they say to you, inquire of the mediums and the necromancers who chirp and mutter, should not a people inquire of their God? Should they inquire of the dead on behalf of the living? To the teaching and to the testimony. If they will not speak according to this word, it is because they have no dawn. They will pass through the land greatly distressed and hungry, and when they are hungry, they will be enraged and will speak contemptuously against their king and their God and turn their faces upward. And they will look to the earth, but behold, distress and darkness, the gloom of anguish, and they will be thrust into thick darkness. Amen, the word of the Lord. Join me in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we are able to not only call upon your name, but also sit in silence and in humility before you to hear your wisdom and word that not only convicts our hearts and our minds, but compels us to continue to faithfully walk after you. Would you make us low at this time? Would you humble us as your people that we would not itch to hear our own opinions or fears or feelings to be the first thing that guides us, but that we would trust in you alone? Would you help me as your servant to continue to hide behind the grace and the cross of the gospel? And would you strengthen me to be bold and to be courageous? And it's in your name we pray. Amen. About 22 years ago in 1999, we had a phenomenon that half of you probably listening were not alive for. We called it Y2K. And it was the instance that at the end of the year in 1999, computers would not be able to understand and shift over from years beginning 19 to the new years starting in 2000 or 20. And the forecast for this was that the stock markets would crash, airplanes would fall out of the sky, all of our identities would be wiped, and the entire world would descend into chaos. And as I was listening to this news when I was about 17 years old, at first it seemed ridiculous, like a movie or a video game, but the news kept coming. And I began to go from a ridiculous perspective to, what if what they say is true? What was more interesting at that time, though, as Y2K's fears were increasing as the year went on, was that certain Christian leaders were saying that this is the sign of God for the end of the world. And it began as a whisper, but especially among the Southeastern Asian countries, including Korea, and even some sects in America, these voices became louder and louder. This was the end of the world. This is when God would return, and everything would be closed and finished under his name. As the year continued to go on towards December 31st, momentum not only grew, but people began to take action with this in mind. And even from our understanding of it, it seemed a little extreme. They sold all of their belongings. And with heartbreak and awe, I continued to read news, especially of churches in Korea, where pastors were calling their members and their congregations to sell everything, to take their money and just throw it in the street or give it away because they would not need any of those things in a couple of days in the new year. But there were two problems with this as they huddled, destitute, giving away even their shoes and all of their money and possessions. There were two problems that happened at the end of 1999 when December 31st was coming to an end. January 1st came. The sun rose, and the world did not come to an end. Engineers and computer people had fixed these problems, and there were some hiccups, but the internet was still there, the stock market was still there, the sun rose again, and the new year began. What happened to the promises, the convictions, and the predictions of these so-called leaders? But more importantly, how could they forget the word of God that spoke directly about this? These so-called Christian leaders had forgotten about God's word in Matthew 24 and 1 Thessalonians 5 when it said, "But concerning that day, the day of Christ's return, an hour no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but the Father only. For you yourselves are fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night." I don't doubt that they were filled with anxiety, they were filled with fear and uncertainty. But in these moments that challenge our souls, that shake the foundations of our lives, these Christians, these leaders, turn from God's word and wisdom to the movement of the world, to the hysteria, and to the so-called wisdom of earthly men and women. In our text today, Isaiah warns God's people in Israel and Judah in verses 11 through 15, that they are doing the same thing. They are acquiescing to the world's wisdom. They are falling away from God. Specifically in verse 12, Isaiah begins with a strong warning against God's people by saying, "Do not call conspiracy what all others, this people, calls conspiracy, and do not fear what they fear, nor be in dread." Judah was caught up in fear and anxiety because they were a small country. They were surrounded by enemies, and more specifically, the powerful country of Assyria was marching their armies against them. And they were uncertain, they were afraid. And even though for centuries God had called them his people, God had given them his covenant, God had sustained them faithfully and faithfully and faithfully, and showed up in this instance as they saw the shining armor of Assyria coming towards their cities, they were overwhelmed by their fear. They were also overwhelmed by the fact that they seemed surrounded by enemies all the time, and God seemed to not show up when they wanted him to. They were impatient in waiting and trusting in God. And so they turned away from not only God's wisdom and word and his promise, but they turned towards idolatry. They turned towards the practices of the rest of the world and saying, everyone is against us. And they even called Isaiah and the prophets of God betrayers of their kingdom and land. Most of all, though, they grew tired of being faithful to God when it seemed so much easier, when it seemed to make so much sense to human minds to live according to the same practices and ways that everybody else around them lived. And so they cried out that everyone else was conspiring against them. They moved away from God's word and promise. Isaiah reminds Judah in verses 13 through 15 that their true identity and place of hope was actually in God, in Yahweh alone, who had led his people through the wilderness, who had provided water and food when there was none to be had. Isaiah says that only God, the Lord of hosts, the creator and holder of all creation, not only chose them, but loved them, and he gave his covenant and wisdom to them. Only God, the Lord of hosts, is what we stand on. Only his wisdom. We are not to fear man or earthly powers, but God alone. In fact, Isaiah reminds them that we are not to fear men or dread men, but we are to fear God's righteousness. And we are to dread his punishment for our unfaithfulness. And this word fear for us is not simply to be afraid, but it's a double meaning of being afraid, but also holding in reverence and in awe in worship. We are not to hold in reverence mankind or human leadership or human wisdom, but the righteousness of God alone. See, the differentiating consequence with God is black and white. There is no middle ground. We cannot serve two masters. We cannot be in two different parties. Isaiah says that if we revere and hold fast to God, he will be our sanctuary. He will guard and guide his people by his eternal power. But if God's people did not wait on him, did not return to his wisdom, did not hold on to the promise of his word, then like all the other people of earth, they would become consumed by temporary fears. They would be led off of cliff by holding on to human knowledge. And that God himself will become their enemy, a stone of offense and a rock of stumbling, a trap and a snare that would catch them in their destruction. Isaiah closes in verses 16 through 22 by reminding God's people that it is God's promise and his word alone that will not only sustain us, but ensures for us salvation in him. More specifically, Isaiah points out in two places, verses 16 and 20, that it is God's word. It's God's word and teachings that hold us in the face of fear and uncertainty in a broken world. It is the only unshakable rock and the thing that we can cling to in the storm. In verse 16, Isaiah says, "Bind up the testimony, seal the teaching among my disciples." What he's saying is that the testimony is God's promise and wisdom. We are to write it out, we are to keep it, we are to know it, and we are to live it out as it transforms us from a scattered and fear-riddled people into the faithful children and nation of God. In verse 20, he says, "To the teaching and to the testimony." And that word, "to the," is not just a one-time turn to, but it's a continuous and ongoing thing. And all things that we go through in life and we endure, we return to the word of God as a thing that reminds and grounds and sustains us in his wisdom. "To the teaching and to the testimony. If they will not speak according to this word, it is because they have no dawn," meaning that if we will not speak and live out of God's word and wisdom, we will have no tomorrow. There is no hope. And there's nothing that we can do to survive. We must turn to and hold fast to God's word as what teaches us of God's character and in God's character, who we are as his people. Isaiah declares as God's prophet to Judah in verse 17, I will wait on God and his word through all things, even though he is hiding his face and blessing from us right now because of our faithful disobedience. You see, the tragedy of the perspective or the point of view of Israel and Judah was that they thought that Assyria and the peoples of the world were attacking them because they were small and easy to pick on, and that might have been true. But we forget that the sovereignty of God holds all people, all kingdoms, and all kings under his authority and will. And God was actually sending Assyria to warn and discipline his people to return to him. This is not only a clear call to return to God and his word, but a stark contrast to show how those in the world live apart from God and the dangerous practices that Israel and Judah were adopting as they became more and more like the world as they let go of God's word. In verse 19, Isaiah points out that worldly people inquire of mediums, fortune tellers, and necromancers, those who call on dead spirits to come and give their wisdom. They inquire of mediums, fortune tellers, and necromancers who call spirits from the dead, like Saul did, rather than trusting and turning to live out of God's promise and word. And he says in an ironic twist of fate, shouldn't God's people turn to God in their time of need? In verses 21 through 22, he says, those who hope in earthly knowledge and human wisdom will be bound or defined by distress and hunger. In other words, those who live apart from God's word and wisdom, those who do not trust in his promise to faithfully persevere, will be defined by the characteristics of hunger, of distress. They will become angry, unreasonable, be judgmental, and hate and curse not only earthly powers that will inevitably fail them, but even God's name itself. Their ultimate destination is and always will be darkness. Beloved, turning to God's word and living out of God's wisdom as we wait on him and trust in his moving is not merely a ploy that pastors have or churches have to sell more Bibles or have a cliche Christian answer. Waiting for God out of his word and wisdom is the lifeblood by which we can know God, know ourselves, and in this live faithfully and obediently, not only when it's good, but especially in the storm and the howling winds of fear and uncertainty. What does this mean for us then in our lives today? Well, there's a couple of reflection points or application things that I want us to humbly consider when it comes to God's word in our lives. We live in a world and society where we place more reverence and defining importance on earthly powers and human wisdom than we do on the wisdom and word of God. We place our hope, our comfort, and strength in the very same things that all the other people of this world do that do not call him Savior and King. We take a look at the stock market, our bank accounts, what political parties we support, human leaders, our assumptions and opinions of things that we hold as the highest authority on earth that we follow, not only on social media, but informing our opinions and lives after. It is the things of this world and not God, the eternal one. We are more afraid of our earthly circumstances, of letting one another down and worship at the altar of idols of this world than we are of worshiping God and holding steadfast and persevering through all things based on the strength and presence that he offers us in Jesus Christ. We disagree with God's timing and promise not being given to us on our timetable or according to our feelings and mood, and we wait on temporary and earthly things rather than planting ourselves in God's promise. We love the text of Jeremiah 29:11 and put it on our websites and coffee mugs, and we share it on artfully staged social media posts. We have to have the journal right there, open with a pen, nice cursive writing, the Bible, and also a cup of coffee. And it also has to be arranged just so that it looks like we are not only artfully inclined, but also holy. But we love the words of Jeremiah 21:11, where it says, "For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. And we read this and we think that it's all good, that we can live in whatever capacity we want, as long as we label or call ourselves Christians, but we are headed for inevitable tragedy because we stop reading there. We don't read verses 12 and 13. Jeremiah 29, 12 and 13 says this, "Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will hear you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all of your heart." God's wisdom is saying to us, yes, I do have a plan for you, for an eternity of redemption, for salvation through the blood of my son, Jesus, on the cross for you. And so I will restore you, I will redeem you, I will be with you and walk with you. You will be my people and I will be your God. But he doesn't stop there. He says, you will pray to me, you will find me if and when you seek me with all of your heart. If you live out of my grace, if you live out of my wisdom and my word. God's word is not calling us to merely read the words in a book, words on a page for an exercise of discipline. God's word calls us to live in and out of God's wisdom as we wait for his moving, as we seek to understand his ways, and in a faithful and growing manner as we imitate and walk after him in obedience, even through the storm. On whose wisdom and word do we wait on for our hope to define and direct us in life? Is it what we see on TV or on social media? Is it what we hear from loved ones and celebrities or people that we revere? Or is our ultimate guide and hope the word of God given to us in Jesus Christ? Especially coming from the Old Testament, when God was talking about his teachings and the law, it was the Old Testament, the Torah given to them, and the covenant of his promises for his people. But the difference in context is that not only do we have those things, but we also have Christ on the cross, which guarantees and assures us a physical symbol and sign of his love for us. But God also gives us the word, the Holy Spirit-inspired scripture and word of God that literally in black and white says, this is who I am, this is what I have done, and this is what I call you to. This word that God gifts us is supposed to be the leading guidance and wisdom of our lives. The second thing to consider are these two phrases that he uses earlier in the text. Bind, seal to the teaching and testimony. Isaiah refers to God's testimony and teaching as his covenant and word. And just as I just shared that the difference in context is that we have Christ and literally the Bible, the word of God, This command to bind and seal and return to is this continuous action. The actual Old Testament language means that these are the things that we are to bind or connect and live in and out of, to be one and the same, and seal and return to the teaching and testimony means that it's supposed to be our instructions for all things in all times. This is given as a revelation of God's grace and covenant, but also it's the food that sustains us. Matthew 4, Jesus reminds us, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone. Bread is not just the physical incarnation of grain and flour and yeast that we eat, but bread represents also earthly things. Man shall not live on earthly things alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. God's word is not a trendy decision, but a way to live and grow. It gives us hope. It models for us and those around us how to respond and live in and out of God's gift of grace and his word. You see, I think this idea of waiting for meaning we learn, we reflect, and we live in and out of God's wisdom and word to not only direct, but to define who we are and what we do. And as we learn more about God, as we see more about God, as we understand how God is moving in our lives and in this world, that we would obediently participate and join in the work that he is doing. Waiting for and living in God's word does not reflect our spiritual maturity and holiness. Far from it. It reveals, actually, humility. Understanding and knowing that you and I cannot do this or figure this out to a near degree of success on our own. It shows that we cannot live and find peace or salvation of our own power and will. What feeds and sustains us What defines and directs us as children of God is and must be God's wisdom, God's covenant, and God's word alone. The secondary thing on this point is that this God's word is not only for yourself, but just as Christ models and gives himself as an example for us in what it means to have hope in the storm, how are we modeling the place and the value and the authority that God's word has for the people in our lives? The very people that God has placed in our lives for us to encourage and influence and grow in the image and righteousness of God. Are we known as a praying people? Are we known as a people that turn to scripture and word, not only when it's difficult, but as the lifeblood of who we are as children of God? Do our children see us returning to scripture in humility? Do our spouses and friends and community members, family members, do they see us in living in and out of God's word as not only the life-giving and sustaining force of God's presence with us, but also as a model of faithfulness and humility? 2 Timothy 3:16 through 17 reminds us that all scripture is God-breathed and useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training. That word training is really loaded, because what that means is that God's wisdom and word training us means that we apply God's wisdom to every part of our lives. Some of us, when it comes to God's word, we just work out. The difference between working out and training is that working out is just, you just think about the muscle group that you want to grow. Biceps, you go to the gym, you get some weights, and you just do the curl. It makes one part of your body strong, but it doesn't necessarily apply always to other areas of your life, to any function. Training is teaching someone how to swing a baseball bat, or how to shoot a basketball, or how to swing a golf club. Training is gaining wisdom and understanding of how the body works and how to play the sport, and saying, stand with your legs shoulder width apart, follow through with your hips, keep your head down and look at the ball. Understand that it's not just about a repetition of reading words in a book, but it's about reading God's wisdom and applying it and obeying it in the rest of our lives. Beloved, especially in the season of COVID and political unrest and social conflict, it has been so easy and yet so difficult to turn to God truly in humility, and to strive to confess to him in prayer, but also to live out of God's word and wisdom. In fact, for many of us, the first thing to go out the window in our stay or shelter in place lives and schedules at home has been this life of prayer and reflection in reading God's word and surrendering to it. And yet God's grace, not only for God's people in Israel and Judah, but for us today, is that he does not condemn them, but he offers them a way back. God continues to invite us, even now, even in our unfaithfulness, even in our idolatry, to return to his presence in humility, to confess and repent, and to once again take part in the banquet of his righteousness and wisdom and word. To wait on God is not laziness or simple inaction. It is a faith-based action of trust that God is present, that he is sovereign, and that he will show to his people not only who he is and what he is about, but about how he desires for us to live by his example and model. In the face of fear and uncertainty, in the face of temptation of living just as all the other people in this world, in the face of frustration, maybe even at God, and not moving according to our timeline, will we trust in his eternal word? Will we trust that if God's answer is silence or no, that his timing and wisdom is greater than ours? And will we wait for him specifically in scripture to not only give us knowledge, but to convict our hearts and to compel us to live forward as his people, to move forward as his people, as it is pleasing to him? Emmanuel, let us wait on the word. Let us wait on the wisdom of God in all things, especially in the storm, as it strengthens us, as it sustains us and feeds us, and as it deepens and widens our identity and our purpose in him, to grow in his likeness of love and righteousness as his children. Let us wait on the word of the Lord. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you that in all things that you are still merciful. Even though you discipline us, it is not a discipline of hatred, but it is one of love. And thank you that you have given us in the flesh not only your Son, but physically your Word inspired by your Spirit. Forgive us for turning to all earthly avenues of wisdom, of worship. Forgive us for striving to try to live and figure things out, especially in our fear and anxiety, the tactics and the advice of other people or worldly structures of power. Would you help us to turn to your Word? And I know that many of us are intimidated by the Bible, but Lord, would you help us to be faithful in striving, in faithfully obeying, and if we can't do it alone, help us to reach out and not only model and be an example for one another, but Lord, that we would strengthen and encourage and read your Word as a community to grow in your knowledge and your love and your likeness. We thank you that this is the anchor of our lives, especially when we are filled with fear and anxiety. We thank you that your Word is with us, both in Scripture and also in your Son, Jesus Christ. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Shaking, we are not shaking.
Emmanuel, now let's receive God's blessing in the benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, may the love and presence of God the Father, and the fellowship and mercy of the Holy Spirit be with us both now and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace.